श्रृंगवीनामुपमश्रवस्तम ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आमश्रृण्वन्नोतिभिस्सेदसादनम् श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् आत्मस्वरूपबन्धुगण वी वर् लुकिङ्ग् एट् दट् वाक्यम् तत्त्वमसि ब्रह्माहमस्मि प्रज्ञानमानन्दं ब्रह्म अयमात्मा ब्रह्म इत्यादि श्रुतिभ्यः सो मकारं कारणं प्राज्ञं चिदात्मनि विलापयेत् वी हैव फिनिश्ड दट आल्सो चिदात्माहं नित्यशुद्ध बुद्ध मुक्त सदद्वयः दट वी फिनिश्ड एंड सो वी विल नाउ कम टू द 51st वर्स यू मे से परमानंद संदोह वासुदेवोहमोमिति देवोहमोमिति ज्ञात्वा विवेचकं चित्तं तत्साक्षिणि विलापयेत् ओके यू सी वी आर टॉकिंग ऑफ एन ओंकार मेडिटेशन दैट इज व्हाट इज बीइंग डिस्क्राइब्ड हियर So, the person starts relating to Omkara. He sits in a given posture and starts relating. At that moment, he is a person. So, as a person, he starts, he has a willpower, because of which alone he comes and sits and starts meditation, right? So, the person starts. The moment you say he is the person, the body identification goes with it. Without the body identification, there is no person. Therefore, sthola upadhi means the physical body as the adjunct that is in the picture. Now, that is the starting point of Om. Then you start saying Om like that. So the moment you started, it has A in it. A plus U plus Om. A is there in it. That O is a diphthong and it has A in the beginning. So while saying A, the person is there. But as the Om further progresses and comes into the U level, that means it is now fully O, then the physical body is resolved. The physical body is resolved means the identity with the physical body is resolved. I am a person in terms of the physical body, that is resolved. All this I have described the other day. And then you now stay for a fraction of a second, as long as that U aspect of the diphthong is, it is there in the sound, for a fraction of a second it will be there. So during that period, you are one with the subtle body as the intellect. Because you are now looking at the Om and its significance, so you are the subtle body. But then that subtle body means the subtle body which has the sthola sharira resolved in it. You see, as you make progress, the earlier thing is not left out. It is resolved. It is devoured. Even in panchakosha viveka, it is like that. So people make a mistake there. Suppose you have annamaya kosha. Then you come to pranamaya. It's not that pranamaya will be there and annamaya will be dropped. It's not like that. Annamaya is resolved into the pranamaya. It devours. So that way the sthola, the physical body, that is resolved into the grass, sorry, subtle. So as the intellect. But then as you come into the then that intellect also is resolved into the sense of being. Just you be, the sense of being. But you recognize, you notice in that sense of being, the sense of alienation is also there. And that sense of alienation is the ajnana. And that is the karana sharira. Therefore now, the intellect body is resolved, of course along with sukshma sthola body, it is resolved into the karana sharira. Now this karana sharira is there. Now that makaram karanam prajnam chidatmani vilapayet. So, by the time you reach the makara, the karana sharira, the sense of alienation is there, but then as the makara tapers off, that nada tapers off, so om, as tapers off, this sense of I am, which is an alienated sense of being, it is resolved in the whole. And so, you now are having a sense of being only, not a sense of being limited. In fact, Mahatmas describe that in that sense of being, you are no more limited to these boundaries. You have a sense of being which is all-pervading. That is the Chidatma. In fact, even I have known Mahatmas who suggest you just be and don't be this or that. Be the whole. See whether you can relate with the being which is yourself as the whole, beyond the limitations. It is possible. There is no big deal about it. So, that is the Chidatmani Vilapayet. And that Chidatma, as the sense of being, it is ever liberated. There is no bondage for it. And only when you superimpose an identity with the sthula, the grass body, subtle body, etc., or you alienate yourself from that whole in terms of a separate being, then only you have the bondage. Otherwise, when you are one with that sense of being, which is boundless, then there is no bondage in it. So, Chidatmaham Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Sadadvayaha. Up to that we have come. So, I gave you a summary of what went earlier. Now, Aham Paramananda Sandoha Vasudevaha. Now, he is just building upon that point. You see, when you have resolved the physical body and the subtle body in the sense of being, then you may abide as the Sakshi. And this Sakshi, Sakshi Bhava, the witnessing attitude, it helps you to distinguish yourself from the physical body and the subtle body. Vivechakam Chittam. So, and once you are in the Sakshi Bhava, then it's only a matter of getting rid of, or it happens on its own, you need not make any effort there. The limitation of the Sakshi Bhava is Vilapayet, and it gets resolved. And so now you are in a sense of being. There is no Sakshi Bhava anymore. Sakshi Bhava is there in the beginning, in the middle, and at the end of the Makara, but once you merge into that silence that follows, even the Sakshi Bhava also merges in it. Then what remains is Aham Paramananda Sandoha Vasudevaha. That alone remains. I am that pure sense of being. That pure sense of being alone is pointed out as Paramananda Sandoha Vasudevaha. You see, what is this Paramananda Sandoha? There is a happiness. Generally, the happiness known to us has a reason. The reason is generally outside. So, that kind of a happiness is a fleeting happiness. And where from that fleeting happiness has come? When you desire a thing and you have a sense of want, now the desired object is gained by you. So, the sense of want has temporarily disappeared. So, when the sense of want has disappeared, that means this wanting limited being has disappeared. The upadhi has disappeared. So, that means without your knowledge, you have gone into that vastu, which is the sachit. And therefore, there you have appreciated that ananda. But then, the sense of limitation comes back immediately. It is like you take a dip into the ocean. Now you are one with the ocean. But then you take the head up again, and again you are a limited being along with the other things. So that way, that sense of happiness which you have tasted when a particular desire is fulfilled, it has not come from outside or from the object. The object has no such capacity to give happiness to us. It has come to us from our own source, from our own swarupa, which is denied to us because of a wanting self. Now that the wanting self has subsided, we have gone into our own true nature and we have gained that ananda. Now, what we are doing is, we are dispensing with this outside object situation. Now there is no outside. When the sthola deha, the physical body itself is resolved, Where is the question of outside? The jagat is already resolved. So without the world and its objects, you gain an ananda which is truly your own. And you see the difference. When you gain an ananda which is of course your own, but due to the nimitta, due to the cause of an outside object, you desire it and you get it. So because of that reason you are getting this ananda. So what a misconception it fixes in our mind. So if at all I have to get happiness, I have to relate to the outside world, desire something and get something, then only I will become happy. That kind of a big mistake, it is formed and it gets reinforced every time you relate to the world in this way. Whereas when you acquire the same happiness without any relation with the outside world, without relating to the outside world, then this misconception is gone and you will acquire an insight. I cannot explain more than this. These are the only words I can get. So you will get an insight, and the nature of that insight is happiness. I need not run a hanker after all these things to become happy. The happiness is my own, and I can enjoy that happiness and I can be happy and comfortable and whole even without relating to the world. So that way, whatever misconception has already formed that the things of the world are necessary for happiness, so that misconception is diluted or even got rid of. Not only that, you will now get an insight into your true being. And from that insight, you can handle the upadhi. Means, when you come back to your normal state where you are one with the physical body, and then you have an emoting person, an intellectual person, etc. So this insight will help you to relate to this thing very comfortably. You know that it is all a superimposition, it's a fleeting thing, and your insight tells you, you are much deeper within yourself. You are not a body. The volume of the body is not your volume. The time scale of the body is not your time scale. You are something more than that. So that insight will come to you, and that is the greatest gain. So that insight is explained here. How? Aham paramananda sandoha vasudevaha. So aham paramananda sandohaschasau vasudevascha. It's a compound word. So both are prathama vibhakti ekavachanam. So I am not only paramananda sandoha but also vasudeva. Paramananda sandoha means an ananda which is not derived from outside apparently. In all other cases it is apparently derived from outside. Here it happens to be my own nature and my own innermost core it is. That is the meaning of parama. And sandoha means with reference to the outside objects, what a happiness we get is just a little. And the amount of happiness you get is such a silly thing it is, such a fleeting thing it is. Before you know what is happening, it is over. And then only dukkha remains. I will come to that later. A lot of analysis is there on that aspect. Therefore, it is paramananda sandoha, means your own innermost core of the being that is in the form of ananda and that has no limitations. That is the paramananda sandoha. Then it is vasudeva. Vasudeva, very interesting. Vasudeva means sarvatrasau samatvena vasatyatreti vaiyataha atasa vasudeveti vidvadbhiv paripatyate. This vasudeva is an interesting word. You see, I tell you how. You are one with your sense of being. And that sense of being, is it known through perception? No. There is no perception. Is it a product of the intellect? No. There is no intellect also. Intellect has gone. In fact, the other day, George Sudarshan was discussing it. He is a man of insight, I tell you. He is a great scholar. He was giving a wonderful example. You see, there is a philosopher, a French philosopher, called Descartes. Descartes said, I think, therefore I am. That is what he said. In Vedanta, we say, I am, therefore I think. The sense of being is the most fundamental, and from that you get the next stage, arises the mind, which says, I think. Whereas Descartes, he said, there is no sense of being, there is no Atma, only mind is everything. He is like Kshanika Vijnanavadi. Kshanika Vijnanavadins are like that. They also say it is all mind, that flickering consciousness which is mind, nothing more than that. Anyway, so he is a Kshanika Vijnanavadi, he said that. It is wrong, we don't accept it. He gave an example for this. Once Descartes went to a hotel, and they gave a card to him. What? Menu card. And then he was reading and reading and reading. He could not come to any conclusion. Sometimes that happens for people. They don't know what is there, and so they are unable to order anything. Then that fellow came. He asked, do you think any of those items will be liked by you? Some such thing he asked the waiter. This person told Descartes, I think not. That is what he told. And immediately he disappeared. Because, now you know, I think, therefore I am. I think not, therefore I am not. So he disappeared. This is the story he gave. So this story is told to ridicule, not ridicule, just to say that what Descartes says is not correct. Because you can experience it in your own life. When you wake up, the mind is not yet active, but the sense of being is already with you. In fact, I tell you, I will use two words to distinguish between the two. I think means when you say I think, already your intellect has come into picture. But just before the intellect comes into picture, Sri Krishna in Gita says, Chetana, he uses the word Chetana, alertness. You become alert. In that alertness, you are conscious of your own existence or your own being, not through the intellect. By intuitive way, you are conscious of your existence. It is intuitive. Intellect will come later. So intuitively, you are conscious of your existence. That is the sense of being. And then in that sense of being there is emotion, and that is the intellect. This is how it is. Therefore, in this Paramananda Sandoha Vasudeva, when you do meditation, then even when the mind is absent, the sense of being is always with you. And that sense of being, it is self-evident. It is not a product of perception, obviously, and it is not also a product of conceptualization as Descartes wants it to, Descartes thinks it is. Descartes made a mistake there. He is not right. So, when you have that fundamental sense of being, and also there is no mind's movement, you intuitively are aware of your own existence. And your own, but not as a person. You exist, that's all. Not as a person. You are, not either be this or be that, no, be. That kind of a sense of existence is there. And that sense of existence, it is called Vasu, Vasati. And it is self-evident. Therefore it is called Devaha, Vasudevaha. It is not a product of mind, etc. But you should not forget one thing. As long as you have a sense of alienation, even in that sense of being, that sense of alienation is there, you are not Vasudevaha. Vasudevaha means the sense of being which has no limitations. That is the Vasudeva. Therefore, you just check for yourself. It is a matter of insight. So you know the physical body identity is gone. That is known to you. The mind's activity is zero. That state of also is known to you. Now you are with the sense of being. That is known to you. And in that sense of being, still you feel a sense of limitedness. That is ajnana. And om iti. When the om resolves into silence, that sense of alienation from that sense of being is gone. It is called the sense of alienation, or the sense of limitedness associated with the sense of being is gone. Once that is gone, you are the Vasudeva. You are a being which is self-evident, Satchit, that is Satchit, which is beyond the limitations of time and space. And in that time, in that Vasudeva, Ajnana adds to that, and then you have a sense of being which is somehow limited and alienated from the whole. And that is the addition of Ajnana. And then in that intuitive sense of being, a movement comes, that is the mind. And then that movement immediately takes the identity of a physical body. That movement takes the form of a body. There is no other body. Movement is the movement in the mind is the body. Otherwise it is panchabhuta it is. So the body is a product of the mind. So when mind starts moving, then you have the body, that is the sthola sharira. And that is the, and then the mind brings in an entire conditioning of culture and psychology. So entire historic self is in place. Therefore you have Mr. So-and-so. So this is the srishti and that is the pranaya. And for this, so to appreciate that the sense of being is not even, that is not limited, and that is one with the whole. So they say, to start with, just in meditation, just to drop the body identity, which is the easiest thing to do, not a big deal. And with a little practice, especially when you do some pranayama, etc., that mind becoming resolved is a foregone thing, it is not a big deal, you can appreciate that. Now you have a sense of being. Now don't allow that sense of being to be restricted. Check whether that sense of being is all pervading. So there Om will help you. Om iti. So Sureshwaracharya, he says, Om iti aham paramananda sandoha vasudevaha jnatva. You recognize that with the help of Om, as the Om resolves into silence, so even this silence, when Om ends, that silence to start with is a relative silence. It is a silence of what? Silence of a sound called Om. But then that relative silence, it expands to an overall silence, an unlimited silence, absolute silence. So that's why Om. So you are in the absolute silence. Once the absolute silence is disturbed, again start Om. And because you cannot stay with it for length of time, then what you have to do? You have to regain it. And to regain it, Om iti. So once again use a Omkara and regain it. And again it is disturbed after a while, regain it. Initially, you may have to say Om quickly. Om, 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 like that. But later, slowly, when your insight increases, you will be with that silence, which is unlimited sense of being, unlimited being it is. So in that silence, the need for repeating Om frequently disappears. So now, Om, Om, like that, with a gap Omkara is used, so that within your own mind you will use Omkara that way. Whenever you find that the mind started moving, it is time to take up one more Omkara. The mind is not moving, it is stabilized, then don't bother about it. You need not start an Omkara. Let it remain without motion. So this is how Omiti Paramananda Sandoha Vasudevaha. Om this way helps you to be with yourself in a true sense. That is how he says. Next verse. Chidatmani vilinanchet tachittam naiva chalayet purna bodhatmanasita పూర్ణాచల సముద్రవత్. సో చిదాత్మని విలీనం చేత్ తచ్చిత్తం. you have a movement of the mind. Chittam is the motion. So that mind movement is there. Now, as the movement stops, you are in the sattva guna. Movement is rajas. Movement stops in the, you are in the sattva guna. And in that sattva guna, the sense of being is still there, but alienation is there. And even then sattva also resolves, very easily it resolves. Then you are only being, not an isolated being, just being. So that is called chidatma. Why you should call atma? Because it has no limitation of time and space. Time-space limitations are there only when the movement of mind is there. When the thought is not there, there is no time and space. You think of yourself, you can feel it yourself. It is not something imaginary. You can feel it yourself. Only when thought is there, time-space. When you are one with the sense of being, just be, there is no time, there is no space. So that is timeless, spaceless sense of being is the chidatma. And the chidatma is there and mind is resolved in it. You are the chidatma. So, tat chittam chidatmani vilinam chet. So when it remains resolved in that pure sense of being, then let it remain like that. Tat chittam naiva chalayet. That means what? Suppose you start saying om with a decision, with a determination. Like, I will chant om frequently, like that. Then what happens? That samskara of the mind, it wakes you up from that chidatma. Therefore, don't have any such samskara. Even before sitting for meditation, you should not plan for the next thing after meditation. So now at 7 I will sit for meditation. At 7:29 or 7:30 Swamiji leaves it. Then I will go for the breakfast. Then immediately I will go and read New York Times. So this way if you plan the whole thing, then the mind, it will present the next course of action already before you. So you have to dehypnotize the mind. The mind is functioning like that. It has become a habit to that. Therefore you have to break that habit. Therefore you do a sankalpa. If mind resolves, then it resolves. The whole world can wait. There is no hurry. So that is what he means. Because naiva chalayat, don't move it means that there is no mind anyway. And when it moves, it won't take your permission. So what is the idea is, you allow to remain it that way. You take a decision that way, take a sankalpa. When I reach the sense of being, I will remain in that sense of being. That kind of a sankalpa you take. And it will remain that way. And when you are with that pure sense of being, that chidatma, it is clearly bodharupa. It is self-evident. It doesn't need any other means of knowledge to make itself evident. It is self-evident. And it is purna because it is beyond time and space. The time-space limitations come only when the mind is active. Now the mind is resolved. Therefore, purna bodhatmana asita. That is same as purnachala samudravat. So a wave started meditation and now the wave, it has dampened itself and then it resolved. Now what is there? Only ocean is there. What happened to the wave? Is it lost? No. It has become one with the ocean. So purna achala samudravat. That achala, there is no movement. Movement is wave. Now there is wave is not there. Therefore it is achala, no movement. And then when wave is there, it has time-space limitations. It is a small wave, big wave, it's a ripple, all kinds, it's a breaker. All kinds of restrictions, identifications come to it. Then wave is not there, then what you have is purna. It is beyond the limitations of time-space. And so it is purna. You are one like that with this sense of being. So, be like that. Purna bodhatmana asita. One should remain like that. This is the Om. Om helps people to do this meditation. My personal recommendation is, if you do some anuloma viloma together with Om, this whole thing becomes a very easy going thing for students. Therefore, for 15-20 minutes do anuloma viloma and then do Om. You may say it loudly or even without making loud noise, just you may move the lips, Om, Like that you may say for yourself, just that sound is required, that's a divine sound it is. It is required for you to resolve the mind. And you take use of that, and once the mind resolves, stay with that Purna Bodha. That way you should stay. It is Sureshwara. Now Sureshwara, this language, this verse, you know, this has it echoes similar ideas or similar advices given by Shri Krishna in Gita and also Gaudapadacharya in Mandukya Karikas. This it is running parallel with Mandukya. So you see, the vakyam, you see, chidatmani vilinam chet tat chittam naiva chalayet. That is how the statement. Now I will tell you from Gaudapada Karika. You see this. Laye sambodhayet chittam vikshittam shamayet punaha sakashayam vijaniyat samapraptam na chalayet. That is what he says. He has viewed the whole meditation from a slightly different perspective. What he says is, when you see for meditation, sit for meditation and do some japam, etc., and the mind becomes calm. When the mind becomes calm, it has now two alternatives available for it. It can slip into sleep. That is called laya. And when you sit for meditation, now you get sleep. the whole purpose is not served. It is good that meditation is working to some extent, but the real purpose is not served. Therefore, what you have to do, laye sambodhaye chittam. You don't want it to sleep. So wake it up. How to wake it up? In fact, some of the yogis, what they do, when they want to sit for meditation, when they find they are likely to slip into sleep, they do a thing called bhastrika. So, like that, with the stomach muscles very powerfully drawn, they do bhastrika. Like for 30 seconds they do. Then all the laziness of the mind is gone. So, they say, some of the yogis, I heard them saying this, laye sambodhaye chittam, Gaudapadacharya gave this advice, therefore we do that. It works. If the person is sleepy, just bhastrika will work. But one has to be cautious about it. If you have food still in the stomach, you should not do bhastrika. It should be totally empty stomach. Therefore, evening may not be suitable time. Morning also, bhastrika you may do before taking coffee and other things. Therefore, don't bother about it. Morning generally when you take bath, you don't need a bhastrika. But because Gaudapadacharya gave a recommendation, I mentioned it to you. Then you have the opposite problem. Vikshiptam. You are too busy. You have so much day waiting for you. So many ideas are crowding the mind. Leave alone sleep, but now it is all agitated mind. Agitated means, I don't mean that you are having some excitement and all that, but still mind is active. Shamayet punaha. You first, before entering into meditation, before pursuing serious meditation, you first make it a little calm. How? By pranayama, anuloma viloma, or nadi shodhana. Just to do a little pranayama for 10 minutes, then the mind becomes calm. Then take the help of Om. Then, because Mandukya is all Om, when you take the Om, to start with, as I told you, sthula into sukshma, sukshma into karana, and now you are with the sense of being, and that sense of being, which is to start with limited, it now merges into the whole. Now you are one with a sense of being which is limitless. So once you are in it, that is called a sama. That state is called a sama. Sama is a Brahman. So samapraptanna chalayet. Once you reach that, stay there. Don't bother about to come out of it. Stay like that. But when you do this kind of meditation, please recognize that the mind is full of ragadvesha. Kashaya it is. Astringent. Kashaya means astringent. So the kashaya of the mind is nothing but strong likes and dislikes. Sometimes Mahatmas say the kashaya could be the unconscious also. That also they say. Even unconscious is what? Unconscious also it has to show its face, and as and when it shows its face, it is in the form of raga and dvesha only. So anyway, so this the raga dvesha samskaras which are at the bottom of the mind, at the bottom means they are hidden in a way. They have not exposed themselves yet. So now it is likely that when you do some japam or some omkara meditation of this kind, when you do some meditation, it is likely it comes out. It is possible. Don't be disturbed about it. Sakashayam vijaniyat. Please note that mind has its own way of functioning. Its own impressions and its own residues. So these residues which are in the form of kasha, which are called kashaya, they may come up and they may cause some disturbance. So be prepared for it. Sa kashayam vijaniyat. Samapraptam na chalayet. So like this, Mahatmas and of course texts, they talk of a meditation. This is all topic of meditation. Now, what happens is, when it comes to talking on meditation, I can talk for 1 hour or 2 hours or 4 hours or 1 week also. But all this talking has its own value, of course. It gives an insight for you and it helps you to gain a lot of vairagyam. And even by just shravanam, your mind becomes calm and a new value system comes into the life. And undesirable values are slowly drop off. They drop off on their own. You need not even make effort. All these are secondary benefits. But the primary thing is meditation. These are all secondary benefits. It's like while cooking food, in the old-fashioned cooking, where firewood is used, if it is winter time, when my mother was cooking food with firewood, I go and sit near that stove, firewood stove, so that by the time her cooking is complete, all my cold is also gone. So that is secondary benefit. Getting some warmth is not the purpose of firing the stove. The stove is put on fire, it was lit for the purpose of cooking. This is a secondary benefit you get. Sheta parihara. So, pake pravurtasya sheta parihara. What? Like that Manasolasa Sureshwaracharya says. So the cold, the warmth is gained, cold is gone. Similarly, just you understand what is meditation, that gives an insight and it gives a new idea of life. Therefore, the analysis is very useful. But still, you have to make it happen for yourself. Therefore, you have to try to do it at home or here. We do, in fact, in these classes, I was trying to introduce that sense of being. Even earlier also, that I am meditation, I used to call it. It is my own name. I am meditation means what? Just bring the idea of I am very powerfully, that's all. So that takes you to the sense of being, and you hold on to that sense of being. That is my advice. You just recognize that sense of being and relate with it. Get connected to it because it is your own swarupa. I don't want to use the word connection. I will say connectedness. Just be connected with it. Develop that connectedness. Means, in your day-to-day life, you isolate yourself from that vastu, which is the true sense of being. That is the sachit. And don't live a life in a total ignorance of, or total oblivion of that vastu, the sense of being. Just come back to it any number of times. Just go back to it and you be with it as often as you can. And the I am, that is the third stage, akara, ukara, makara, or even om, you can take its help. So, just all the time revert back to I am or go back to om. And if you find some agitation in the mind, just get hold of a mala and do a mala japam. And if you feel some anger against somebody, then it will not help this process. In fact, it is detrimental to the whole meditation. Therefore, when you feel that kind of anger or frustration or any such strong emotion, immediately be alert about it and take a mala and do japam. The emotion subsides. don't allow it to overwhelm you. So this way you revert back as often as you can, maybe twice a day, to that fundamental sense of being. And then, I tell you, then the transformation will happen. You need not bother about transformation. In fact, that so-called anxiety, we call it spiritual anxiety, even that will disappear. And that sense, you just be connected to that sense of being. I'm using a language as if you are separate and that vastu is separate, which is not true. But then we have to use that language. So we say the ego, aham, is the arrow, and the Brahman, which is the innermost sense of being, as the goal, as the target. So we are talking of a journey. So it is a from journey of yourself to yourself, or it is a journey from yourself to yourself, a journey from the body identity, from the emoting person, from the intellectual person, into that fundamental sense of being. Try that journey. It is the way. If there is anything called practical Vedanta, that is the practical Vedanta. There is no other practical Vedanta. You cannot, aham brahmasmi cannot be practiced. If at all any practice is there, this meditation of this kind, this alone will help you. This is also called Nididhyasana. People ask often, what is Nididhyasana? This is the Nididhyasana. Dhyanam is different. In Dhyanam you have an altar of Ishvara, either Shri Krishna, etc., in the heart and all that, and you relate to that, offer a flower of mind, all these things are Dhyanam. But this is Nididhyasana. Here, there is no such division. In fact, the entire effort is to resolve the difference and to sink into your own source. So, Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi talks about it. So, Hrudi Visha, Manasa, Swam, Chinvata, Majyatava. So, take the physical body into the mind and then you enter into the Hrut. Hrut is Parabrahman, Satchit is Hrut. So, enter into it. How should I enter? He uses two words, chinvata majjatava. So if you take om, under that om, if it helps you to dive into that vastu, majjanam is diving. Diving means what? The way we have described, sthula into sukshma, sukshma into karana, karana into the sense of being. That is the type of diving we are talking. And so you do that diving and enter into that sense of being. And if you find some difficulty in this dive, that majjanam and omkara, it may become difficult, mind being what fickle. So if you find any difficulty in that majjanam, chinvata, no hurry. You can do majjanam later. If you find your mind is not yet ready for it, do chinvata. Chinvata means take the physical body and then negate it. That is the chinvata, neti neti. So then intellect, negate it and stay with ayam. That is chinvata. Chinvata means anveshana, searching for it, like Hanuman searches Sita, like that. So you just handle it by neti neti and stay with ayam. And then your fickleness of the mind will reduce and the life's values also support it. Now you are ready, majjata. Chinvata majjatava. And then he goes one step, Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi, he says, if you find that even this kind of chinvata majjata, so chayanam and investigation, chinvata is investigation, majjata is diving, just getting resolved into it. It is, you are not yet ready. Then he says, chinvata majjata va, pavana chalana rodhad atmanishtho bhavatvam. If you find the mind is too fickle, then practice pranayama, pavana chalana rodha. That is the pranayama. Pavana chalana rodha is pranayama. And then having done a little pranayama, do chinvata, stay with ayam, just investigate. In a guided meditation situation, that is what we do all the time. Or majjata, take omkara, omiti majjata. That way, hrudi visha. You be connected to your sense of being. Be connected. And that connectedness with the sense of being will make you a strong person. These ups and downs of life cannot shake you. You can remain like a mountain in the face of a tempest. This is how the whole idea of Nididhyasana is presented. We'll take up the next verse.
एवं समाहितो योगी श्रद्धा भक्ति समन्वितः जितेन्द्रियो जितक्रोधः पश्येदात्मानमद्वयम्.
यू सी आत्मा अद्वयम् आत्मानं पश्येत. एवं इन दिस वे समाहितः बाय फोकसिंग द माइंड and by the alertness associated with Omkara, just an alertness, be alert and resolve the physical sense into the intellect and then into the Makara and then into the sense of being, just alertness, that alertness will take you into the Vastu. So this way you do. And then evam samahitaha yogi, this is the yoga. Yoga is not just doing Shirshasana for 15 minutes or half an hour. That is not the... Just it is one small aspect of yoga. And you take a small thing, asana, and then highlight it to such an extent that all others are obliterated. That is not the yoga. This is the yoga, true yoga. So you are the yogi. Tasmad yogi bhavarjuna. Once I was sitting in some meeting. One yogi. Yogi means the atta yogi. He says, Sri Krishna so told, tasmad yogi bhava Arjuna. Therefore, he advised Arjuna to become yogi. Therefore, you do Shirshasana every day, half an hour. No, that is not the way Sri Krishna advised Arjuna. Yogi bhava Arjuna means, you do Nididhyasana and be with yourself. That is what he said. So yogi is jnani chartha, yoga nama jnanam. We will see what is this yoga further in Mundaka also. I will discuss. This is the topic for coming 2-3 classes. So, this samahito yogi, an alertful person who has a pursuit of vastu, he is called yogi. So, samahito yogi, advayam atmanam pashyet, he has to see advaya atma. See what? What do you mean by see? See as himself. That means be ityartha. So, in all these, the seeing is not like seeing a path or any such thing. But the language, everybody has to use a language, you know. We have to use a language for an inexpressible, ineffable vastu. So, that is the dilemma. But then we try our level best. So, pashyet atmanye vatmanam pashyet prahadaranyakashruti. So, pashyet means pashyati ityarthaha. So, you take this mind and resolve in its source. And all the division and all the time-space variation, the variety, plurality, is in the mind only. The moment you resolve the mind in its source, what you have is advaya atma. In that true sense of being, pure sense of being, you don't find any divisions and all that. The divisions are there only when you identify with the physical body. Therefore, that advayam atmanam pashyet, that is the proposition. And you have to make use of the omkara as it is presented. But then Sureshwara, here he starts an entirely new direction. He says, all this becomes possible only when your lifestyle is in place. So he comes back to the original story. He has said what all he can say about om. But what more he can say about it? He has exhausted himself. About Om. Now he is emphasizing on the sadhana. Generally, you see, the effort of the shastra in teaching or of the sadhaka, the seeker in the pursuit is on the sadhana path, on the pursuit path, not on the goal. Goal, there is not much to be said about the goal. So, it is like an Indian marriage. In India, the marriage is fixed, time and date is fixed, date and time, perfectly. It is called Muhurtam. So, on so-and-so date, morning at 10:24, they say like that. And in India, they may not follow punctuality in any other thing, but here they are very punctual. So, very strict it is. And 10:24, in fact, they synchronize all watches also, all around some 4 or 5 people, The Purohits, marriage Purohits always have a watch, good watch they have. Their radio time, they say like that. In India it is called radio time. Radio time means the radio news, 9 o'clock news, it will say, it makes some sounds, beep, 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 and then sound, news starts. So that beep comes, he checks it is 9. Like that it is radio time. And 4 or 5 people are ready. 10:24, then he says one mantra. And the Mangala Sutra Dharana is over. That is the marriage. And by 10:25, the marriage is over. If it is delayed further, then the Muhurtam is already crossed. He cannot do that. That is not acceptable. By 10:25, the marriage is over. And that is 1 minute. And for that 1 minute's sake, you believe me, once he has done that, 3, I tell you, he is with her and she is with him for the life. So, generally, that is how it is, for the life. Now, that is such an important event it is. It changes the lives of 2 people, one young lady and one young man, irrevocably. There is no looking back. There is no mechanism to annul it. And it is final. Such an important event is done in 1 minute. And the preparation for that 1 minute takes 1 month. So, to have an insight and to be Brahman, it's not a big deal. But the preparation requires a lot of effort. Therefore, that's why Upaya occupies a lot of space, lot of explanation, etc. is in the for the Upaya only, preparation only. The final thing kya hai? It is just 1 minute thing. That's why we say every climax is an anticlimax. You expect see, then it is over. You see, there was one episode which I have seen. There is a flower. It blossoms once in 12 years. And it happens night at 12 o'clock or 11 o'clock. So they are waiting for that occasion. Since 2 years they are waiting. And now 2 months, they are waiting 2 months, like World Cup cricket waiting. So they are waiting, that day came. Since morning they made all preparations, they are waiting. Now night 11 o'clock it will blossom, or 12 o'clock it will blossom. They are waiting. And 11:59 they are ready. Then suddenly there was a big sound there on the other side. Everybody turned that side and turned this side, it has blossomed already. So like this. So you may wait for an year, but finally it happens in a second. And it is an anticlimax. Therefore, Brahmajnanam also will be an anticlimax. You know why? You will think, oh, I have missed this truth all along. That way you think. You become so connected to the vastu. Therefore, don't bother about the climax and anticlimax. Just take care of the root. Therefore, we have come back to the square one. Root. So what is the root? Shraddha Bhakti Samanvitaha. You should have Shraddha. I am not going to talk about Shraddha anymore. I have talked enough of this Shraddha. In Mundaka I have talked. So Shraddha we should have. Bhakti. Shraddha is enthusiasm. That energy comes out of Shraddha. Bhakti is one should have that meltingness. You should melt. That should be there. Otherwise what happens, it is all faking and contriving, life is all like that. All false smile and all diplomacy, hypocrisy, one should not live like that. When it comes to certain emotions, one should learn to melt before that emotion. When it comes to loving a person, one should melt in that love. Don't count his weaknesses or her weaknesses and all grievances. Suppose wife and husband, they have to melt in the love of each other. They should learn that. Not all the time complaining and all that. So, anyway, just I gave one example. So one has to develop that, inculcate that meltingness. This is my new word. meltingness, like beingness, new word, meltingness, that is bhakti. So, in fact, that is how Madhusudana Saraswati describes it also. Bhagavad Bhava Drutasya Dharavahigata Angata. The bhakta, when he hears the Bhagavan's nama, or he contemplates on Bhagavan, his mind just melts and flows. Dharavahigata Angata. It is a very true thing, very real it is. Just mind melts and flows. So one has to appreciate that it is indeed so, and one has to gain it. So one should not be dry and harsh. Root nahi hona chahiye. So dry, harsh, so rukshaha in Sanskrit we call it. Very dry. Suppose you have these powders, some seed chili powder, etc. You have to put a little oil, otherwise you cannot handle it. It comes into nose and all that. Oil makes it comfortable. So dry is unbearable. So similarly, heart should not be dry. It is filled with happiness. All the time complaining and negative attitude, and all the time desiring and fear, it makes the heart dry. One should not be like that. One should have that love. One should develop it. One has to make a decision. From now onwards, I am going to love this person, whatever may be the reason, whatever may be the occasion, cause. Yes, I am going to love the person. And one has to remind itself all the time. So one should not be this or that, just be the love only, that's all, don't be anything else. So that way one has to grow into it. And that is the bhakti. And that bhakti makes the person ready for understanding the ultimate reality. When you have so much of hypocrisy or contriving or artificiality in the mind, that mind cannot reach the vastu. So, I know Mahatmas, they say Atma, Atma idam sarvam, they say Atma, Atma, and then there are drops of water in their eyes. The word Atma moves them to such an extent that Shankara, Brahmajnanam, Atma, that makes them ecstatic. So that kind of a devotion is very important. Otherwise what happens, you know, it becomes mechanical. The mind is very deceptive, very stupid it is. It makes everything mechanical. Therefore, we'll be doing puja and it becomes mechanical. We'll be doing japam, it becomes mechanical. You inhale and exhale, that becomes mechanical. Everything, it just makes it mechanical. So you should not allow that to happen. It happens, but we have to come back. And so, bhakti is very important. One should never neglect bhakti, that Ishvara bhavana. Some people, what they know, consciousness, awareness, only they hold on to this consciousness, awareness. But then, if bhakti is there, it helps. So, avinayam, apanaya, vishnu, like that, I have taken that text particularly to introduce bhakti, because that text is all about bhakti. Therefore, bhakti is very essential. Shraddha bhakti samanvita. So Shri Krishna says, bhakti manme priyo naraha, one who has bhakti, he is very dear to me, he is my atma, priya means atma. Therefore, so one has to carefully cultivate shraddha bhakti samanvitaha. Jitendriyaha. You see, these are all important. Shri Krishna says, shraddhavan labhate jnanam tatpara sanyatendriyaha. You know why he should say that? You think about it, I tell you. Here is a brahmachari, or a young man. He has a lot of enthusiasm. And so, shraddha. He goes to the Gurukulam. And then, there he starts studying. With a lot of application of mind, he is studying. That is called tatparata. He has both. But, he has no indriya jaya. So, he goes to university. He has a lot of enthusiasm to the studies. He has passed a degree or a high school with good marks and acquired a seat in some very good MIT or some say in India, IIT-like place he goes. And now he has all the application of mind. And within 6 months he says, I love that girl. What is this loving a girl? It has no relevance at all. You are not supposed to love a girl while studying. So in fact, one MSc first year candidate came to me. MSc microbiology he is studying. Microbiology is and that too, Usmanaya University School of Microbiology is world famous. Very good school. And he got seat in it with difficulty and he is studying it. It has 2 year course. After 1 year he says, Swamiji, I have loved a young girl and now I want to take my father's permission, please help me. I told, when you get time to love a young girl? Are you ready studying microbiology? When did you get this time? So, he was a good student. So he has got a Shraddha, he has Tatparata, but Indriya Jayam is not there. So, just I gave you a practical example. That's why we say in that sequence. Because people have Shraddha, people have Tatparata, Bhakti, but Indriyas, they don't go by your Shraddha and your Tatparata. They need some discipline. Indriyas need discipline. Therefore, jitendriyaha. Shri Krishna, sanyatendriyaha. Indriya could be when it comes to taking food. You should have jitendriyatvam. Similarly, in all other areas. So, one can love a young lady or a young lady can love a young man, but not while studying. Just study is over. And now you say, I have finished my MS. And then I want to take a job. In the meanwhile, I will get married also. Wonderful. You love a lady and you marry, whatever. But not while in the middle of the examinations, he loves a lady. What kind of thing it is? So that Indriya Jayam is missing. It should not miss. It should be there. Otherwise, what happens? This Shraddha and Tatparata, it takes a different route. And finally, Papam, poor fellow, he has got so much enthusiasm, he has put in so much of effort and all that. Finally, he ends a mediocre way. He cannot reach the ultimate goal. Therefore, jitendriyaha, that must be there. Jitakrodhaha. I tell you, krodha and bhakti, krodha or dvesha, anger or hatred, and bhakti, they cannot live together, they cannot stay together in the same heart. They are not compatible. It is like computer compatibility. So this software is not compatible with that software. So if you want to open that document with that particular software while having this operating system, it won't open. So similarly, bhakti and pain, they can exist together. Dukkha. Bhakti and dukkha, they can exist together. They don't have any contradiction. You may have pain in your heart, you may have bhakti in your heart, okay, it goes on. After some time, pain will be taken care of, bhakti gets stronger. Kuch bhi ho, what happens later, but you can have both. There is no contradiction between the two. But bhakti and dvesha or krodha, anger or hatred and bhakti, they don't coexist. So, it's a matter of the opposition of one to the other. Therefore, you should take care that anger and hatred, they are at a distance. Even Shankara says, anger means, even when the other person gives occasion to be angry, you should keep it at a distance. Then only, otherwise, if everybody is cozy and comfortable, then you need not have anger. What for? Therefore, even when there is an insult, or a justifiable cause for anger, then you should keep anger at bay. So this way, we have to clean up that mind and we have to safeguard it. That is our wealth. A clean mind is the only wealth we have and only capital for Atmajnana. And so we have to safeguard it and then make the positive steps. Then Atma is our own Swarupa. It is the easiest thing to achieve. It is not at all difficult. Only we make it difficult by going in the opposite direction. So we'll continue. ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ तत्सत् श्रीकृष्णार्पणमस्तु